Okay, so without further ado, we'd like to present our play, which is based off of Disney's animated film Frozen and Voltaire's novella Candide, Frozen in Thought.
I know, right?
Okay, wait. So you have how many quarters?
311. Only one less than you. And they still refuse our marriage.
That's horrible!
That's what others do.
And brothers. The bear and I were really close when we were little, but then one day, he just shut me out. And I never knew why.
I would never shut you out.
Can I say something philosophical?
I love philosophy!
All my life has been a series of doors in my face, and then suddenly I bumped into you.
I was thinking the same thing, cause like, I've been searching my whole life to find my own place. And maybe it's the Craigslist teaching or the chocolate fondue.
But with you,
I found my place. And it's not the like I've ever seen before. Love is an open door. Love is an open door. Life can be so much more
with you.
With you.
With you.
With you. Love is an open door. I mean, it's crazy.
What?
We finish each other's
sandwiches.
That's what I was gonna say. I've never met someone who thinks so much like me. Jinx again. Mental synchronization. We can have but one explanation. That you
and I
were meant to be.
Say goodbye
to the pain of the past. We don't have to feel it anymore.
Irony is how Voltaire was able to become the second most renowned satirist in history. He was second only to the great Jonathan Swift, the author of such beloved books as Gulliver's Travels and A Tale of a Tub. Voltaire uses irony to mock these topics because he felt philosophical view was unrealistic, and he does not think the world is a utopia. The foil of Martin is a pessimist and the polar opposite of Pangloss. Both Pangloss and Martin often speak verbal irony. That is Voltaire's way of mocking these Enlightenment ideas that the group will elaborate on later. And then the didactic preachings of Martin tell us of the corruption and the unfair nature that is all around us, while the preaching of Pangloss tells us that this is the best of all possible worlds. And then, for instance, Voltaire writes things like, with properly legal procedures, he was asked which he would prefer, to be beaten 36 times by the whole regiment, or to receive 12 bullets in his brain. It did him no good to maintain that man's will is free and that he wanted neither. He had to make a choice. Using the gift of God known as freedom, he decided to run the gauntlet 36 times, and he did so twice. And this quote is dripping with verbal irony because he's talking about, like, oh, God gave us this free choice, but he has to choose between being shot 12 times or being whipped 2,000 times, and I really don't want to choose either of those. And then he believed, or there's dramatic irony in the novella that surprises us, in that with a lot of the characters died, or we thought they died, and then they just kind of came back. Like, I thought Pangloss died twice, and they're still alive. I didn't really like that, kind of wanted to die. But, and then the same magnitude. That happened again with Pangloss. They're like, oh, he tried to hang me, but he didn't know how to tie noose, so I just didn't die. And then that was at a comical twist to the novella, similar how there was a comical twist at the end of that song, where normally Anna and Hans are getting married, and they just met each other. So that's kind of crazy, they're getting married. But we changed that, and that was dramatic irony, because you all expected us to get married, and unfortunately we're not getting married.
We shouldn't say that. Also, another reason why we did that is because Hans never deserved to talk to Anna, because he was evil. But that's another thing. What?
This song satirizes the concept of love. This song depicts the love of that exists between Candide and Cunegonde. Although the song ends in Cunegonde rejecting Candide's love, this is not true in the novel. The ending of the song was just to give you, the audience, a prime example of dramatic irony. The love story between Candide and Cunegonde is far more complex. In a nutshell, Cunegonde dies and then is a property of like 50 pimp like men who utilize her body, and then she becomes ugly and makes Candide marry her anyway. The song in the novella satirizes why love through the use of dramatic irony. The concept of folly of love is also mocked in the novella through the character's opinions of love. Cunegonde's permission to marry his sister, Cunegonde's brother, the Baron after her father dies, does not give Candide permission to marry his sister, because he is littered with only 311, which is 71 quarters. This shows that the Baron does not understand that love is a powerful force, and it does not recognize the boundaries of the lineage. The love that Candide and Cunegonde share is a strong bond that cannot be broken. Candide leaves El Dorado, which is basically heaven on earth, with all the gold and the gems and all, no fighting or whatnot. But in the end, he leaves because he wants to go back to Cunegonde. In the end of the novella, when the star-crossed lovers are reunited, Cunegonde is but ugly, and Candide still agrees to marry her because he has made that promise, and they understand that love is not forced to be tempered with. The same concept that love is not forced to be tempered with is seen in our love for Frozen with Cunegonde, Shrodes and Nick.
Anna and Hans.
If anyone tries to talk bad about this movie, one of us will probably karate chop you. Like, no, seriously. We'll karate chop you. This satirizes the folly of love. It's also a manifestation in chapter 16. The Orians, the Aurelians, are savage people who make love to monkeys. And they're portrayed as uncivilized and uncultured. Not only do they have sex with animals, but they want to eat the Jesuits as well. Voltaire attacks the lightning beetle of love in his chapter, and the savage Iranians are good but effective way to do so. This concludes Act 2, Scene 2.
Wait. Before we move on to the next one, I have something to say. Open the curtains! In a normal manner. I don't understand. Why can't we get married?
He has the script. Talk to him.
Why don't you have a script? I'll say it again. I can't believe it. Why can't we get married?
Right there.
Right here.
Oh, you're lying to me. Whoa, man, just let it go.
Okay, but I'm just saying, love isn't an open door for anybody.
Well, look at that. For the first time in forever, you said something philosophical.
Yes. As Pangloss would put it, love is like wanting to build a snowman in summer.
Gosh. The script is definitely a
fixer-upper.
I'm sorry for leading on all those horrible puns. Anyways, let's just move on to the next
Wait,
scene.
Before that, these emotions inside of me, I cannot keep them inside any longer. I must release them in a sing-along.
Let's go.
This is a story all about how my life got flipped, turned upside down. I'd like to take a minute, just sit right there.
tell you how it became the novel written by Voltaire. In Westphalia, born and raised, listen, Pangloss was how I spent most of my days. Living in youth and endowing all cool, while getting private tutelage instead of school. But then I met a girl, her name was Kunagon. We started making out, the Baron wasn't fun. Our one little kiss was to his dismay. Said you're banned from the castle for the rest of your days. I begged and pleaded with him day after day, but then he packed his suitcase and sent me on my way. He gave me a cake and then he gave me my ticket. I put my good suit on and then I said, I said, I'm gonna kick it.
Where's my life? Help is there from my mouth. Is this what the people of Europe live in like?
This ain't all right.
Oh wait, here's a pricey, Fortois and all that. Is this the really tough place they want to send the school cat? I don't think so. I'll see you when I get there. When I hope they're prepared for the book of Voltaire. Oh.
I have to do that. That's all. Sorry. I have to do that.
Now that that's out of the way, I need three volunteers. Like Sophie, Madeline, and
it is always so nice to see all these hands go up when groups ask for volunteers, especially when you know you're going to be up there dancing and singing or something.
Dancing.
So, hands off, Abdul.
Actually, no, I don't. I like the one out there. It's okay.
Why is it
I'll just falsetto the whole
time. No, it's not!
When we do the solo, I won't do solo.
Oh, I won't do solo. Yeah, I won't do
solo.
I
won't do solo. You ready for this one? You ready for this one?
Thank you. Oh, baby.
I just cannot get over the fact that this world is not perfect. In fact, I think this world is the opposite of perfect.
I agree with you. I mean, why would a perfect world have such things as rape, earthquakes, unjust executions, diseases, AP tests, mistresses, and religious hypocrisy? Not to mention, that war that lasted for like 7 years, I think that war was pretty gnarly.
How many people do you think died in that war?
10?
Wow. I think it was more like 900,000 to 1.4 million people who died in the 7 years war. But that's not what's wrong with the world. What is truly wrong with the world is how Leonardo DiCaprio has never received an Oscar.
Wow, that voice is right. This world is not as perfect as it seems. Philosophers have a weird way of looking at things.
I don't want to live on this planet anymore.
Wait. Why does this never work? Oh, great.
What's the issue here?
Why are you so pessimistic about the world?
The way the people rape, or those deadly earthquakes, or the unjust bias hanging up and gloss.
This is a sing along.
And though we know it has diseases like syphilis and measles,
but you
never be in a universe that's more alike. You're a little optimistic, this world doesn't have any laws. You're the bishop who starts with their mistress, starting by our great God. You're a little optimistic.
I did not have to do that.
And going back on this YouTube test by God.
suffer. It's a minor thing. Your word enslavement is a flex arrangement. And by the way, I think it's just a fling. Just a bit of a bill and suffer. Her brain's a bit betwixt. Get Instagram out of the way and the whole thing will be fixed.
I'm not saying you can change it if the world's needed.
Candide satirizes the concept of optimism and how many philosophers are looking at life through a narrow lens that does not include such things as rape, earthquakes, unlawful and biased executions, tsunamis, syphilis, and corruption. When they do encounter these things, they simply say that everything happens for the best. The folly of optimism is satirized both in the novella and in the song by making something as terrible as syphilis seem like it was actually beneficial to the world because it's catastrophic. Although chocolate may be a delicious treat, I would prefer not to have body parts fall off to eat it. Right. During the Enlightenment, the thinkers at the time valued earthly life, the nature of man, and the individual achievement. This optimism placed a strong emphasis on the accolades of an individual instead of the accolades of a group, as it was done in the past. These attitudes culminated to create a new spirit of optimism. Thus, the belief that man was capable of achieving greatness was born. And then the rediscovery of old texts brought about a new perspective of the world. Similar to the perspective of Pangloss, the metaphysico-theologio-cosmonagologist, and this phrase is strong verbal irony, and Voltaire's attacking the beliefs of the intellectuals at the time, because the term ego is similar to the word nincompoop in French, and that Renaissance thinkers study classical subjects that address the human instead of science. This optimism embraced the humanities of language, literature, art, history, rhetoric, and of course, philosophy.
Alright, so this song mentions the deadly earthquake, which is a way for Voltaire to satirize the deadly earthquake that occurred in Lisbon in 1755. There was also another earthquake in Lima, Peru in the same year. And Pangloss said that all this is for the very best, and for if there's a volcano at Lisbon, it could be in no other spot, for it is impossible, but things should be as they are. Everything is for the best. Pangloss said that this earthquake kills many people for a reason, and everything exists in the world for a reason. This is like optimism. But throughout the book, we can see like that Candide brought in Pangloss' optimism teaching. Like everything he said, when he had to escape from the police, Candide said that. The sea of the New World is already better than the European sea, it's smoother, the winds blow more regularly. Like, how can you tell? I mean, that optimism shows that he's looking forward to the New World, but in the book we found out that he got destroyed, his optimism, because all the bad things happened to him, like, he killed the Baron by accident, and his beloved got, like, taken away from him, and that he lost all the riches that he could ever wanted. Okay, and When Candy was on his way back to Europe, he found the sheep again. So he said that let's make the best our way to gaining that. What kingdom shall we purchase with our riches? So he's looking forward to buying like a whole country already. He's not even like halfway home yet. This optimism, like, got disproved by Mark, who was a pessimistic person, and show Candy that in real life there was not everything is optimistic.
Beautiful day in the neighborhood. Beautiful day for a neighbor. I love life here in Dorado. People call it utopia. That must mean that we have lots of attractive women or something like that.
Why, hello.
Sir. Change to madam.
We have just arrived here and we're wondering if you could perhaps give us some directions. We are directionally challenged.
Just look around. You're in El Dorado, the most wonderful place on earth.
Mother of God. Candide, have you ever been to a place more perfect than this?
Wait. I'll see you when my computer responds. Nope. But sometimes I like to. Where are we? Guys, and imagine what other worlds would be like. Bees are buzzing. Kids will look like that with gold hooks and fingers, and I'll be doing what every man does in Dorado.
This plan, the streets cut jewels like bubbling. Why don't you give me a helping hand in Dorado?
Finally, the big cheese and our welcomes will be warm. Our friends may be fake, but it will not matter when we get home. And I can't wait to see what my buddies will think of me. Just imagine how much cooler we'll be in Dorado. Ta-da, ta-do, ta-da-da-da-da-do. Kudagon and gold are both so intense. Put it together, it just makes sense. What?
Winter? No, we're on this ahead, but this is Ethiopia. Great philosopher!
When life gets slow, I like to hold on to my dream of relaxing in the stream. The sky will be blue, and gold bars will be there too. When we finally do what rich people do tomorrow.
Not without me.
Queen Elsa. Okay, I'll try to be short about this. That last song takes a look at Cacambo and Candide's departure from Utopia, aka El Dorado. In the novella, El Dorado represents Voltaire's actual idea of a utopia, a place where everyone agrees, there's no excuses for hardships, and everything is shared. The purpose of El Dorado's inclusion is, as many things in the book, to satirize philosophical optimism. As Nick has already discussed this generally, I would like to focus on key figures such as Leibniz. As you know, Leibniz is made fun of for his philosophy that we live in the best of all possible worlds. Voltaire goes as far as on several occasions he just quotes terminology straight from the philosophy, such as the contingent or non-contingent events of this world on page 124. But Leibniz's actual philosophy was a little weirder than that. He believed that our world contained all possibilities, yet it was still the best, which doesn't really make sense at all, but that was his philosophy. And it's But it's through this idea of an optimal universe that we get the term philosophical optimism. It's not because he's an optimist and happy about everything. It's an optimal universe.
I never told the guards to open the eggs.
Leibniz was also known as a great contributor to other areas such as metaphysics, which is mentioned in the book, with his idea of monads, which is a theoretical object that everything in the universe is made of. Kind of like atoms, but I think it was weirder than that. And he also was one of the inventors of the calculus you know today, with all the integrals and derivatives. You know, who could thank for that? And he was known of trying to make mathematical formulas out of everything, and trying to relate everything with math. Back to the song, we also attempted to make allusions to what happens to Cacambo and Candide after they leave El Dorado with a massive amount of wealth. And throughout the next few chapters of Candide, Voltaire targets his satire on the corrupting power of money. Candide is fooled in many ways, well, in practically every way possible, by variously greedy people. They befriend him, overprice him on various things, make up pitiful stories to get him to give charity. They pretend to be Cunegonde, and they even imprison him to get his money. And this shows Voltaire's hatred of social classes and why he believed a perfect utopia would be without currency. Now, back to the play.
For this being the best of all possible worlds, I feel like we have to endure a lot.
Yes, my love. We've endured more than imaginable, but now let's get married and have lots of babies.
Oh my god. I can't marry that dumb princess.
What troubles you, my love?
Nothing, my princess. Just wondering about, the future!
Our future?
Oh, get a room. I know the perfect place. We can purchase some farmland and we can become farmers!
But why?
Well, things do not matter unless we apply them to our lives. All of this philosophical speculation is meaningless if there's no ultimate reward. We have indeed endured a lot, and now we can take a break from the hectic life of travelers and settle down into enjoy the small things in life.
You are absolutely right. All this philosophical speculation, I guess the best thing to do would be to let it all go.
I think I feel an Oscar-nominated song coming on.
Me too! I'm not sure if my math does. Philosophy's replaced by ethics tonight. Also, this is our last scene. A world of imperfections requires us to be keen. The wind is howling like this swirling storm inside. Couldn't keep it in, heaven knows I tried. Those sayings are great, but now it's time to be the farmer I always had to be. Feel, don't feel, don't let them know. Well, now they know. Let it go. Let it go. Special chores. Let it go. Let it go. Turn away and slam the door. Care what they're going to say. Let the world rage on. Pangloss never bothered me anyways. Not yet! Oh, well, keep it off.
Yes.
Times of distance makes everything seem small. And the doctrine that controlled us can't get to me at all. It's time to see what I can do to test the traffic on my and breakthrough. No wrong, no creep.
me. I'm free.
Found some joy working in this garden now.
We didn't parody these lines.
Who's all this rhyming in frozen fractals all around? This crystallizes like an icy blast.
Oh my gosh.
I'm never looking back. The past is in the past.
Asked Miss Chance to do it, but in asterisk it said like sexual implications.